Okay, everyone, thank you very much for joining us for this session, which I think is actually central to the whole thesis of this event, which is that what is fundamentally wrong with a lot of agriculture is that we've moved away from any elements of integration, of diversity, and of sustainability, in the sense that mixed farming and integrated farming systems can have benefits for wildlife, for soil, for water management, and we're going to be looking at those issues specifically in a minute or two. I'll just briefly introduce you to our panelists, who are Kristine Nichols from the Rodale Institute. I'll introduce them all in slightly more detail in a moment or two. Professor Claire Kremen from UC Berkeley. George Boody, who's from the Land Stewardship Project. And Seth Watkins, who's a farmer, who's very kindly come along to tell us about his production system. Now, I'm just going to make a brief introduction. Now, these are slides from the UK, photographs from the UK. I don't have any particular US ones, I'm afraid. But just to make the point about the type of farming systems we want, this is part of East Anglia in Lincolnshire in the UK. And it looks quite pretty in a way with the yellow and the green, but actually all you've got represented in that photograph are two crops, canola, as you call it over here, or oilseed rape, as we call it, and wheat. And that's become the predominant rotation in most of the cropland in the UK, with canola grown 1 year in three and wheat grown 2 years in three. And they just go back round again for that. And what I'll argue is that this is really responsible for the decline of pollinating insects in the UK. We've only been growing canola like that since the 1970s, and it's now taking up a very large percentage of arable land in the UK. And roughly, you can where that yellow is today is where you'd have seen grass and grazing animals back in the 1970s and before that as part of mixed farming systems. And to some extent, we are living off the fertility that's been built up by thousands of years of grass and trees growing on farmland all over the planet. And while it varies, if you go to parts of South America where land has only recently been converted to food production, they've probably got 100 years or so before they start to see problems. But if you take parts of the prairies in the US, parts of East Anglia in the UK, well, we've had a couple of hundred years of crop production and not been putting back to restorative crops. We're coming towards the end of that cycle, and there are huge potential problems for future food security. A couple of UK government scientists have actually predicted that within the next 50 or 60 years, we will not be able to produce crops on a lot of the arable land in the UK. Here's a more traditional picture of mixed farming. Now, this is not part of Africa. This is also prime arable land in the UK, which is showing signs of soil degradation and soil erosion, just because it's been kept in crop production. And one of the points I want to make is that while a lot of campaigners are calling for everyone to eat less meat, quite correctly, we've got to be very careful that we don't get rid of all grazing animals, because grass is one of the key crops which actually is restorative. And I used this slide yesterday, but it really is very graphic. That is how increasingly a lot of food that we're eating is produced. In South America, it's almost a pastiche of what's happening, but because some farmers are doing that, because some big companies are funding that type of food production, it's pushing farmers all over the world to move in that direction, otherwise they can't compete. And you know, you have to ask yourself, how long is that soil going to stay in those fields when heavy rains come? And if I showed you some of the photographs of some of the river systems around there, they run brown with the soil from those systems after the rains come. Now, this is a map from a few years ago, 1997, just showing how much of the global soils are actually already degraded. Some of this is due to overgrazing by animals in some of the tropical regions, some of the dry land areas, but a large amount of it is due to crop production. The red is the worst, but you can see how how most agricultural land is being degraded to some extent. Is that the figures are 52% of all soils globally have been degraded, either severely or moderately. And we're losing 24 billion tonnes of soil a year from agricultural land, 75 billion tonnes if you take sand loss as well into account. That's 3.4 tonnes for every human on the planet. So for every, Americans eat on average 1 tonne of food a year. So for every tonne of food you eat, you're each responsible in a way for 3.4 tonnes going into the river and ending up in the sea. That's not sustainable indefinitely. Now, just very quickly, integrated farming systems, which in my view, in an ideal, are integration between livestock and cropping, but that's not possible in many cases. So it could be integration of different types of livestock in the same farming system. It could be companion planting in a crop production system, a whole range of methods to actually make that. So you can get fertility building with integration, you can get diversity, and you can get complementarity. You can actually break the weed, pest and disease cycles and return residues to the farmland more quickly. And just here, that's a photograph of prairie grass, which used to go down 20 feet. And one of the reasons why there's a lot of fertility in the prairies is because grazing animals were grazing that land for hundreds, if not thousands of years, and building up fertility, which we've been using up. Here, this is grass roots showing, grass is one of the one crop that has three times as much material underground as above ground, which is one of the main reasons why it's the best way to fix carbon. But the problem with that is that we can't eat grass, and that's why we need grazing animals. Okay, that's my slide. So I'm now gonna ask Kristine, who's chief scientist at the Rodale Institute, an organic farming institute, and a soil scientist who used to work for the USDA, to give us her presentation about soil and why we need to look after them better. Let me give you this.
Okay, very happy to be here, and I'm just going to pull up my presentation quickly, if I can. Get down to the toolbar. Okay. Nichols, that one. Yes. Thank you. So, you know, what does soil have to do with food? I'm sure that we've heard throughout this conference that soil has everything to do with food. And so, really, when we're talking about the true costs of food, we have various choices here. We have the choice of business as usual. This is a picture from 1970, but it's a lot of business as usual. This is actually the Rodale Institute, where we have our research farm. This is what our research farm looks like today. So this is from 2000, but very similar to what our research farm looks like today. We have a very integrated farm production system. We have livestock that are in the system, not just cattle, but we've got chickens and goats and sheep and a number of other types of animals in the system. We have an orchard, we have vegetable production, and we have grain crop production. So it's a very integrated type of system that we're looking at for food production. But again, we have choices to make as to what the cost is and what the costs of this and what the true costs of that in everything that happens within our ecosystem and how our ecosystems function. So really, I believe that one of the things we need to focus on is the fact that we have a carbon problem. And I'm trying to create a movement. So all of you are now going to be a part of the movement. Welcome to the movement on recognizing the fact that we have a carbon problem. And so I always say to people, hi, my name is Chris. I recognize that I have a carbon depleted soil. I'd like to regenerate my soil. Would you come along on the journey with me to regenerate my soil and support me with this? So you get to go home and talk to your spouse or your significant other or your friends or your neighbors and tell them that you're now on this journey of being able to improve the amount of carbon that you have in the soil. We have a carbon problem. It's not always, when we talk about a carbon problem, we're talking about it atmospherically from a CO2 climate change perspective. But really, if we alleviate the carbon problem that we have in our soils, we're not going to have all of these other problems that we call problems. They're actually issues. And so for every farmer that's out there that's talking about, you know, the issues that they have in agriculture, oftentimes you say, well, I can't grow this here because it's too cold or too hot or whatever. If really we're able to build on this idea of a carbon problem, we can create a resilient system that's able to thrive under all of these climatic changes and all of these resource constraints and still be able to produce food if we focus on what the true problem is. And so that's why I'm saying that you're all going to join me on this journey, right? To recognize the carbon problem. So what we've got below ground, I'm a soil microbiologist, and what we've got below ground is very much tied to this carbon problem, to this carbon economy. Everything runs based on energy and food. And that food is the carbon, and the carbon flowing through all of these different organisms that are in the soil. So the plant trades photosynthetically derived carbon to fungi and bacteria primarily in the soil, things like mycorrhizal fungi that help to provide nutrients to the plants, things like rhizobium and other organisms that are going to fix nitrogen. You have both symbiotic and asymbiotic nitrogen fixers. So it isn't just about rhizobium when we're talking about nitrogen fixation. You have things that are going to help to solubilize phosphorus. You're going to have other things that are going to help to solubilize and make available the nutrients that are in the soil that the plant needs. And the plant has evolved over 500 million years in relationships with these organisms in order to have this chain, this trading going on. And so that's very important for us to recognize that carbon resource. And we started to take carbon out of the equation when we supplement the soil or amend the soil with chemical nutrients. What we want to do is we want to have the soil organisms be able to provide those nutrients for the carbon cost, because the cost needs to be paid. The question is the cost going to be paid by you as a farmer, or is the cost going to be paid by the plant? The plant has 500 million years of knowing how to pay the cost. So it's not a problem of not knowing how to pay the cost. The other thing is that these organisms have actually created soil. We didn't have soil before we had this relationship occurring. And when we have soil in this environment, it has gone on to expand to things like aggregate formation and creating soil structure and expanding that ability to have this function at a much greater levels of efficiency. And then you have things like nematodes and protozoa in the soil that are very good at eating a lot of bacteria and fungi. And that's going to release a lot of the nitrogen that's in the bodies of these organisms. This is how things are cycling through, is through all of these different dynamics of all of these interactive organisms. So it's a very simplified type of strategy that I have here. But the idea is focusing on the carbon economy, focusing on the carbon problem to be able to address these issues. So what we've got in the soil is all of the organisms, and I apologize, sometimes this is black and sometimes it's white, I don't understand. Anyway, all of these organisms are starving and homeless. And that's what we need to do in our system, is we need to create a system in which we provide them food, i.e. have a living plant growing as much as possible in the system, and that they have a pretty good habitat. So you want to reduce the amount of soil disturbance. That's all you have to do. They'll do the rest of the work for you. You just have to do these key things in order to be able to. This is your cost. The true cost of food production is to provide food to the organisms so they're not starving, and to provide them with an adequate habitat. That's it. That's what we have to be focusing in on. So at the Rodale Institute, we have the farming systems trial, and I just wanted to present a little bit of information about the farming systems trial. I have a few brochures if anybody wants more information about the farming systems trial. You know, please feel free to look up or contact me at the Rodale Institute. But what this is, we're now in our, it said celebrating 30 years, we're actually now in our 36th year of continuous production trial. It's a side-by-side comparison of organic and conventional methodology for crop production. And what we've seen in this, so we've got an organic manure-based system, which is our integrated system. We've got an organic legume-based system, which is integrated on a different scale. It's utilizing a different plant in the integration. And then we have a chemical conventional system that we're comparing side by side. And what we've seen over time is the impacts that these systems have. When you have an organic-based system, when you have a biologically-based system, it is much more resilient. It is much more able to respond to all of these different conditions that you'd have. So these are side-by-side plots in our research study. They are actually literally side-by-side. There's about a 5-foot buffer between each of the different treatments, and they're replicated across the field. So what we've got here is after a rainfall, we went out there and took pictures. This is the same wheat crop that you had there, but we have wheat in a conventional system, and we have wheat in an organic system. So again, this resiliency, how are we going to be able to manage climatic uncertainty? You can't control rain, but you can control the way that the soil is going to be able to respond to those conditions. So that's what happens when we get too much rain. Now look at what happens when we get too little rain. Again, now you can see them in the field. This is the 5-foot buffer between these two. So we've got our organic on this side, our conventional on this side. Oftentimes farmers will look at this because we have a very yield-based focus on agriculture production. They'll look at this field. We had our farmer who manages it, our farm manager, was very, very upset because in the early spring, as far as color was concerned and some size, this field actually looked a lot like that field. It was very bright green. It looked very, very healthy. And the organic field looked kind of sickly to begin. And that's because we're challenging the plants to have to trade carbon to that soil environment. Where are the costs going? Who's paying for those costs? That's what we're trying to design here. But you're not harvesting it when the crop grows in the spring. You're going to be harvesting it after this happens. So as normal in many of our agricultural production regions, we have spring rains and you have some fall rains or fall snowfall, but during the summer you don't have much water. So this is what happens. Now we run out of nutrients on this side and the plant starts to get stressed. And so we had a higher yield in the end in the organic system than the conventional system.
We've got about 3 minutes left.
Yeah. This is what it is that we're producing in the system. This was actually this year. Similar type of thing happened in Pennsylvania. We had the Rodale Institute is in near Philadelphia in Pennsylvania. What we had in the system was we had very abnormally high rainfall amounts in the early spring, and it was a very dry late summer. So what ended up happening when you drove around this area is many of the cornfields looked like this. Many people were saying, well, we had a drought problem. The problem with this, if you sell these side by side, these are literally, again, side by side. You see these side by side and you're like, okay, so it rained on this side of a 5-foot buffer, but it didn't rain on that side of a 5-foot buffer. It's amazing what these buffers can do. There's like a little wall that's the invisible wall. It's great. No, this is a problem with what happens when we try to use chemical management as opposed to biological management of resources. So in this case, in the early spring, with all of that rainfall, we added enough nutrients for this to produce 200 bushel corn. And so based on the recommendations from our local university extension agent, we added enough nutrients. What happened with a lot of the rainfall is the nitrogen leached out and the phosphorus leached out or ran off. So we lost those nutrients in that system, whereas in an organic system, that had to rely again on the biological resources to get that to function. So this is what we're starting to see as we look at this. In these two plots, this one yielded 18% higher than that plot did. So we had that then again translates to yield. Now these plots, our conventional corn is always planted earlier than our organic corn, and it's a longer day corn, which in a typical agricultural production system means that it should yield higher, because longer day usually indicates a higher yielding variety. We plant a shorter day in our organic system because we utilize cover crops, and we utilize the cover crops to their maximum potential. So they have to grow a little bit longer into the spring. So again, when you go up close, now you can really see the nutrient stress as opposed to it just being water stress. So we have to start asking ourselves when we look at things like drought events, is it really water that's the problem, or is it the way that the system's managed? So this is what we end up seeing, is we end up seeing in our system, in our chemically based system, that we lose roughly 30 to 50% of the nitrogen fertilizers used by the plant. Somewhere around 30% of the phosphorus fertilizer is used by the plant. The farmer still pays 100% of the value for a product that is less than 50% efficacy, has an efficacy rate of less than 50%. I don't understand. My dad's a farmer. I talk to him about this all the time. I don't understand why he doesn't go and knock on his fertilizer dealer's door every single day and ask him where his money is. Nobody would pay 100% for a product that has a 50% efficacy or less rate. But that's what we're doing in the way that we manage our systems. And it's a very energy intensive process when we're relying on chemical nitrogen fertilizer. But what we want to do is we want to utilize these things that are in the soil, like the arbuscular mycorrhizal fungi. So about 4 to 30% of the carbon is transferred to these fungi, and they create these hyphal networks below ground. And these hyphal networks can fuse together between different types of plants. So I'm actually going to look at this one. So between two different types of plants that may be growing side by side, the network that was growing in a legume-based plant will fuse with a network that is growing from a grass-type plant. And what will end up happening with this is the grass has basically taught the mycorrhizal fungus over time. It gives off a carbon-based signal that tells the grass how to, or tells the fungus how to be able to accumulate phosphorus against a gradient. So it will do that. It will accumulate, hyperaccumulate phosphorus. It got that knowledge from a grass. And now the grass says, all right, I have enough phosphorus, but now I have a nitrogen demand. And the fungus says, all right, you know what? I got to deal with this legume that I tapped into this network that this other fungus is colonizing this legume. So I'm going to ask the legume for some of the nitrogen. The legume says, well, in order to give you nitrogen, I need some phosphorus because I need phosphorus to feed the bacteria because it's an energy intensive process. So you get this trading that goes on where you have essentially all of these organisms working together. Now, the other thing that makes it also very efficient is the mycorrhizal fungi have phosphorus solubilizing bacteria that will colonize their hyphae. And they will solubilize the phosphorus. The grass told the mycorrhizal fungus how to absorb that phosphorus against a gradient. Now you have all of that phosphorus. Some of that phosphorus can go to the grass. Some of it goes to the legume. The legume gives some of it to the bacteria. The bacteria gives some of the nitrogen to the legume. The legume then gives some of that nitrogen to the fungus so that it can get the phosphorus that it needs. The fungus then gives some of the nitrogen to the grass so that it knows how to pick up phosphorus against a gradient. All of this stuff is happening in the soil. We can do that. It happens simultaneously. We can do that, or you can pay for it. And that's what we're talking about when we talk about the true cost of food. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think somebody should write a song about that. It's about your knee bones connected to your thigh bones.
Exactly.
So if you'd like to come there, can you swap with Christine, with Claire, is that okay?
Yes.
If you come and sit there for a second.
Yeah, I'm just
The next speaker is Professor Claire Kremen from UC Berkeley, who's an entomologist, an ecologist, I think she'll correct me if I've got this slightly wrong, and she's got a particular interest in integrated crop systems in horticulture.
There you go.
Thank you.
There.
Okay, thank you very much. Following on what Richard introduced, he was talking about how integrated farming systems or diversified farming systems, as I like to think of them, can have benefits for wildlife or biodiversity. And I want to talk about the reverse of that, how the biodiversity can really provide benefits for the farms and the farming system. And this really also builds very nicely off what Kristine just talked about when she elucidated all of these things that are happening on the soil. These are all biotic interactions that are happening in the soil. So, biodiversity can provide a lot of benefits for farming. We can think about pollinators, for example, how important they are in crop pollination. But at the same time, biodiversity can also provide some costs to farming. When we think about the pests, those are also elements of biodiversity. And then some of the benefits that biodiversity provides may be very invisible to farmers. So all of these soil microorganisms that Kristine actually just explained for us, all these complex interactions. It's really like a black box, that soil, what's going on there. But so much of importance is happening there. So when it is invisible, however, the biodiversity may not be really valued by the farmers. Elucidating the values that biodiversity provides to farming through science could be a powerful motivator to farmers to adopt diverse, sustainable farming practices. That is essentially the point I want to make here. So what we do is we conduct on-farm research, and we are attempting to identify the benefits and the costs of these kinds of integrated, diverse farming systems. And we do this work in the, and so what I'm going to do is give you a very quick example of some recent work that we've done on this topic. And we're working in the Central Valley of, in the Central Coast region of California. It's a major strawberry and lettuce producing region, and we're working on strawberry. We work on 27 different farms. And these farms vary. They're all organic farms that we're working on, but they vary from being highly diversified in the crops that they produce to being very simplified or specialized and producing only strawberry. And they also vary greatly in their surrounding landscape. So from very complex landscapes that include lots of different types of natural habitat around the farm, as well as different types of farms around the focal farm, to very simplified landscapes that are essentially mostly other strawberry, large-scale strawberry farms. And in this study, what we're aiming to do is look at this gradient of diversification from the specialized to the diversified farms, and from the simplified to the complex landscapes, and how that ecological gradient influences indicators of biodiversity that we're studying on the farm, and then how that translates through to ecosystem services. As I mentioned, all of these farms grow strawberry as a component on the farm, and we're looking at ecosystem services that are relevant to farmers on that strawberry crop. So we're looking at pest control, disease control, pollination, soil nutrients, and soil water holding capacity. We're also looking at some other ecosystem services that are more outward facing, that are more benefits to the public, like greenhouse gas emissions. But I wanted to focus today on what's beneficial to the farmer. So the story I want to tell, we started this work a year ago. So these are early results that I'll be presenting, and these are the most accessible results on bird biodiversity and what are the benefits and costs of bird biodiversity on these farms. So birds can control pests. The insectivorous birds do control pests. And so we were looking at the interaction of these birds with a very important pest on strawberry, which is the ligus, the tarnished plant bug. And when this ligus bug interacts with the strawberry, it pierces into the strawberry flower or into the fruit, and it causes the strawberry to not develop properly. I don't know if you can see it quite well, but the strawberry gets very seedy, and it's not a marketable strawberry any longer. But birds can also be pests themselves, so they can, and they do, certain bird species will eat the strawberries. So it's that balance that we're interested in. So in our on-farm study, what we do is we look at, we create enclosures up there that prevent birds from interacting with the strawberries, either as pests or as pest control agents, and then we compare those with regions right next door that are open to birds. And so we've done the study on 6 farms with a number of different pairs of these cages and control areas on each farm. And then what we do is we look for the telltale signs of damage. What are the bird damage marks and the ligus marks? And we also do, on all 27 farms, surveys of birds, so we understand which bird species are there. Not just these birds, which are actually the pest birds, but all birds. And so let me show you our early results. So firstly, when we look at the plots that are available to birds and those that are caged, that exclude birds, then not surprisingly, we find more bird damage on the ones that are out there for the birds, and it's about 5%. So about 5% bird damage when the strawberries are available to the birds. But interestingly, when we look at the damage from the ligus bug, then we find that when that's about 5% more when the birds are excluded, when they're not available to control the ligus bug. So those two really pretty much match each other out. And we also find that when the birds are excluded, we do indeed see a lot more ligus in the caged areas where the birds are excluded. So the basic message here is that bird pest suppression, that's the insectivorous birds, cancels out the damage from birds themselves when we look across all the farms. But what's interesting is to think about how the bird communities actually vary across this ecological gradient that we've been studying. And so what we found is that we see more pest birds and more damage from pest birds in these simplified landscapes. But we see more insectivorous birds on the diversified farms and landscapes. So the way that the farmer is managing the farm and the landscape that they find themselves in determines this bird community and then determines that balance between the costs and the benefits that the bird community provides. And our diversified farms and farming landscapes have really promoting these better birds and also suffering less from bird pest damage. So I want to conclude by just suggesting that it's really important to get out there and try to monitor and measure and account for these different ecosystem services, because many of them are extremely valuable to the farmer. And it's only in doing this that we can understand this situation and reveal valuable information for farmers that can then begin to create a sort of dialogue that we can have with farmers around these practices. Now, I was asked to speak about pollinators, but it really hasn't come into my slideshow, so because pollinators is sort of my own main thing. So maybe I'll just leave that and see. Well, I was thinking maybe if people want to bring it up in the questions, yeah, then I can do that. Okay?
Thank you very
Great.
Much.
Great, thank you. All right. Pass this on.
Hi, everybody. My name's George Boody. I'm with the Land Stewardship Project, and we're primarily farm and rural organization with urban members. We organize folks to take, I can do this too, but we organize our members and constituents to get involved in the public policy decisions that affect their lives, get involved in democracy. We have a Farm Beginnings training program, and one of the things we're involved in is this watershed project in the Chippewa River watershed in western Minnesota, called the Chippewa 10% Project. And I acknowledge our funders and thank them for their support. I'm just going to sit down so it might be easier to see, if that's okay. Chippewa River watershed's about 1.3 million acres in western Minnesota. And I guess what I want to say about it is that if you look in the south, it's very highly agricultural, primarily corn, soybeans, and sugar beets country, pretty flat, highly tile drained. As you go east and north, it gets more diverse. There's glacial moraine country, there's poorer soils, there's more integrated crop and livestock systems still on the land with options, and there's some prairie remnants going through the state. Oops. What I also want to say is that these six sub-basins have been monitored for water quality for about 18 years, so there's a lot known about the trajectory in them. There's some challenges. So as Ray Archuleta of the Natural Resources Conservation Service has said, our soils are naked, hungry, thirsty, and running a fever. And there's some examples of that here, where there's highly black soils, there's a lot of fall plowing, there's a lack of buffers in some cases, and there's the water coming out of tile lines raises these stream levels pretty quickly and erodes the bank. And actually, it's a lot of soil from the banks, and then if you can see this, there's sort of a line right here between those arrows. That's total suspended solids coming into from the Shakopee Creek into the river, and that's also due to algae from growing from the nutrients that get into the water, in part through tile lines and in part through runoff. And of course, we do have problems with livestock in the stream and continuous grazing. Now, I will say to you that we've been involved with some research that suggests that cows can have access to the streams and streams corridor if it's done right. So, but this is not being done right, that picture. Kylene Olson of the Chippewa River Watershed Project, our primary local government partner in this, would say that we spent millions of dollars 500 landowners have changed practices, and we're still impaired. So these red areas are official impairments under the Clean Water Act for turbidity, for dissolved oxygen and bacteria and so forth. So it's time to do something different. And so we've selected three focal areas in the colors to work in. We try to target our outreach to landowners in those areas as much as possible. And the gray area is something called the Minnesota Prairie Plan, which is trying to introduce more habitat diversity. I'm just keeping track of my own time here. One of the things we're trying to do different is something called the 10% solution. That's not the only part, it's a partial solution. But in the watersheds where there was those sub-basins where there was 35% perennial cover of any kind, they met standards in the stream. And the watershed as a whole is about 24%. So that's where the 10% comes from. Can we get a goal of getting at least 10% more cover to get started? And will farmers adopt it? And what will happen in the streams over a period of years? And can we track that? We have lots of partners, and the partners bring resources. We work with the ARS lab here and the university and others. And we're focused on continuous living cover. And for we work with a partner called Greenlands Blue Waters, which is a consortium up and down the Mississippi River particularly. So we're looking at perennial crops. With farmers, we're particularly looking at managed rotational grazing, which is a system of higher stocking density and moving animals quickly across paddocks, and sometimes hitting it really hard once a year and then moving on. So there's different grazing strategies. But that brings higher profitability to the farmers, and it brings greater conservation benefits because the land, there's always a good canopy of plant cover on it, as we heard this morning. Longer crop rotations with perennials, cover crops, particularly multiple species cover crops, are easier in an integrated livestock system because animals are there to eat them. And we're working with the University of Minnesota, which is breeding winter annual crops through an initiative called Forever Green Initiative. And also looking at perennial wheatgrass with the Land Institute, so which could be used for livestock feed. So livestock helps make this more possible, I guess I would say. It's easier where there's livestock. So the approach that we take on this is an organizing approach. We've held 300 one-to-one conversations with farmers we do cold calls with. And the approach that we take is to go out and we're open about, we're here to talk about water. But we first ask them about the history of their farm, what it used to be like. Did their grandparents live there? We talk then, ask them about the legacy that they'd like to leave. What matters to them? What matters to them about the farm? Then some of the barriers, and it's at that point that some of their stewardship values begin to come out. So values of stewardship, values of community, legacy, family, the importance of family. And then it's at that point oftentimes that people say, well, yeah, I'd like to do something different, but this is inevitable. This is the way the system works. I don't have much choice. And so at that point, our role is to try and empower them to see options, to take responsibility, and to actually take action. So it's giving a sense of agency, helping them bring their own sense of agency to the issue. We organize people in networks because this is about rebuilding community. This works better when there's a community of people. We use learning incentives like the Haney Soil Test to track the change in biology, say with cover crops before and after. We also have a conservation cropping systems calculator that we put together to help make a per acre comparison cost between corn, soybean rotation, adding cover crops, adding actually comparing grazing or different kinds of grazing systems. And we can map part of their farm. We hold workshops. We hold something called a BioBlitz, which is a way of involving community in the whole thing, tracking. So networks are important. It's about building community. farm women landowners, in this case, and recreational landowners, are important. They own as much as 50% of the land. They need a sense of agency to make changes as well. And one of the things that we're doing is looking at how we move across a landscape. And actually, this is working. We've removed invasives on part of this landscape because animals have been removed. And then woody species come into a former prairie area. And it doesn't function as well, actually. The grassland deteriorates. So we're actually working with six landowners, public and private landowners, to move, combine herds and move across the landscape. Question is, what happens at a landscape level? So we've used some hydrological modeling to try and estimate this. The green is continuous living cover perennial systems, including grazing. 3.7% of the landscape in the entire watershed leads to an 18% reduction in in-stream nitrogen loads, according to this model prediction. That's more effective in this case than cover crops or reduced nitrogen by 20% on larger acreages, according to the model. Now, if it's functional, and actually some of the indicators suggest that farmers can make money, what are some of the barriers? It varies by year, certainly, but as much as 19 million or more comes in for corn and soybeans through risk management insurance and so forth a year into this particular watershed. We talked about this lack of agency. The narrative that technology will solve problems, that it's about economics, is held by the crop insurance advisors. It's held by the entire community. That's part of what has to shift. Some of the costs, $31 million to lessen bacteria and turbidity is the estimate for the plan to clean up the water. Our outreach costs money because we're doing this individual organizing engagement. And in some areas, a portion of the wells are higher than drinking water nitrate standards. So what's the cost of redrilling a well? And reduced recreation and so forth. So our approach is that we need to shift narrative, as I mentioned, and ultimately markets. Part of the work that goes well beyond this watershed and is actually multi-state is we need to work on federal crop insurance reform because it skews the system. And first of all, I think it's important to acknowledge it can be achieved, that it should be directed to improve fertility and the broad public good, not primarily benefit the largest landowners and farmers, and it should be shaped by the people affected. So this is a matter of holding meetings, engaging people. What could this look like? What should it look like? What do people want it look like? It's an important program for farmers. And we need to integrate continuous living cover into models. Most models don't understand grazing very well. They certainly don't understand rotational grazing and the difference between that and management intensive grazing. And we're engaging other watersheds. And we think we need to be bold, so we're advocating that the governor of Minnesota set a goal of 20% living cover by 2020. So we'll see. So that's it. Thank you.
Excellent, George. Thank you.
Oh, where are we now? We're maybe 2%.
Just one point of clarification. Those numbers you gave, that 19 million and the 31 million, how big an area of land does that actually relate to?
Well, it's 1.3 million acres. There's about 600,000 acres of corn-soybean rotation explicitly. There's 85,000 acres of corn-soybean sugar beets. So it pertains to particularly those acres.
Okay. We'll ask some more questions in a minute when we get on to the discussion. Thank you. And the final speaker is Seth Watkins, who's a farmer from Iowa. Is that right, Seth? And he's going to come and tell us about his. He's on a journey, I think, in the direction which I think many of us will be heartened to hear. And he's going to tell us about what he's doing on his farm.
Oops. I am. SFT. There we go. Hmm. All right, thank you all for having me today. And I'm probably better at farming than public speaking, and I like to use notes, and I've noticed that with the podium, sometimes I'm going to look over here to know what I should be talking about. I think I wanted to start with this slide because as I worked through this, and I guess it's kind of beside the point, I became really tickled at how many of my favorite things originated in the United Kingdom. And I looked at my Hereford cattle that I love very much, and my Angus cattle, and my Border Collies, and the Presbyterian church I go to on Sunday. And I'd be remiss if I didn't mention Scotch whiskey as well, all of which are key and very important parts in my integrated farming system. So, how's this work? This one? Nope. Okay. So anyway, we've got the nice thing. I had a lot of smart people ahead of me that described a lot of the things, so I'm going to be able to breeze right through this without a lot of explanation. But they did give me three topics to speak to you about today. The experiences and financial consequences of diversifying a farm, key economic and social barriers facing farmers in moving from specialization to integrated crop and livestock systems, and number three, the farm is a holistic system and a long-term approach. What are the benefits of investing in the future? So let's start here. Here's a little bit of background about Pinhook Farm. We're located in southwest Iowa in what's called the Southern Iowa Drift Plain, and I think it's really important to point out the Midwest is far more diverse than we realize. The challenges I face with the ancient soils of the Southern Iowa Drift Plain are far different than what Jim may face in northern Minnesota with soil type and structure. You know, I'd love to see diversified systems everywhere. I'd probably make the argument that there's more of a need for them where we have 600,000-year-old soil and some of our issues than maybe Jim may have more pressing issues to deal with on different aspects. I have these. Our revenue sources, and I think this is pretty important, we are diversified. Our revenue sources come from beef cattle. We run about 600 mama cows. We also raise corn, hay, alfalfa, some cereal grains, and rotation. Most of this is used as winter feed for our cattle. We do outfitting. I'll explain why soon. Our most recent venture in the last couple of years, we do land mitigation for lead offsite credits. And I get USDA subsidy payments. I think it's really important that I am very clear. I am a farmer, and I do get money from the government. True cost won't work without transparency. So out of the way right now. And my wife's great job as an early childhood special education teacher. So let's talk about the journey and the experiences of developing a diversified farm. Until 1998, I was pretty much a poster child for production. I did exactly what my industry told me. I focused very hard on the latest and greatest production techniques. I was convinced that with use of science, technology, and sheer determination, I could beat anything that Mother Nature threw my way. And the only thing from time to time I would see things or feel things that maybe didn't feel quite right, but then I'd go to the local Farm Bureau dinner, they'd give me a free hat, they'd tell me I was feeding the world, and not to worry about all those things other people were saying, and the left side of my brain would take over and I'd go right back to full on production. My journey changed when in March 11, 1998, we had a severe blizzard. And we made it through, but it was something when I watched it, it was something I never wanted to see the cows or the calves or myself or my helpers to experience again. And when it was over, instead of doing the linear thinking example of going to the people I'd look to answers for, of saying, how do I solve the problems for this blizzard? I asked a very simple question. I asked, why am I working against Mother Nature instead of with her? And asking why was really the beginning of my journey. And as I contemplated this question, I realized that it's not right to see a baby calf shivering and trying to nurse a cold, muddy udder on a March day. Even though the industry said, hey, you should calve in February and March because you need to have your calves ready in November, I don't know where that came from, and it didn't feel right to see that. And I decided that from that point on, my sole purpose was not going to be production anymore. I was going to completely change my focus, and I was no longer going to focus on production. I was going to focus on having three things. I wanted clean water, healthy soil, and happy cows. And with one simple shift, we moved to having the calves born in mid-April. And I really didn't even care if I went broke. If I changed my system and I went broke from it, at least I could sleep at night because I was addressing the things that mattered. But when this calf came in April, something very pleasant and unexpected happened. My production actually increased and my profits went up. And this is for a variety of reasons that we'll get into. But as we went through, happy cows need more than just calving on lush green pasture. They need diverse forage. They like legumes, they like forbs. And this meant that we stopped broadcast spraying because my legumes and forbs don't like these things. Rotational grazing played in because happy cows do like to move around, and this is good for our system. And they like clean water. So we actually became very obsessed with focusing on how we cared for the health of our land and our water, and we saw a lot of good things start to happen. And this is a quote I do like very much. Good things, as well as bad, you know, are caught by a kind of infection. And it's by another one of my favorite Englishmen, C.S. Lewis. And I think this tells a lot about what we deal with in modern agriculture. You know, you can also run a CAFO, and you can have some bad farming practices, and you can look at it and adapt to thinking it's okay. But on the other hand, with the right catalyst, you see some wonderful things happening. So, as the good things came along, I naturally wanted to implement some of the same practices and see if the same things would work out on our farming system. And our farming system includes no-till, crop rotation, cover crops. We also, we graze our cover crops, and we even take it to another step. We found out it makes a lot of sense sometimes to identify farmland that is marginal and not productive and not farm it. And that's actually been one of our greatest revenue boosters, and we'll talk a little bit more about this later. I've lost my spot. Anyway, as we work through, I know what I wanted to talk about. This is the place where I think it helps to explain why I'm still consider myself a quote-unquote conventional farmer. We still do use some GMOs. We still use certain chemicals. We don't use them in a prophylactic manner. We use them more as a tool, and I think that there is a differential. Some farmers do use these products as a crutch, and I know what happens, and that's unfortunate. For us, they were the tools that allowed us to adopt better systems. My no-till system didn't start to work until we actually had GMOs and the Roundup Ready products, and it allowed us to move away from some really nasty products that we used to have to use. So sometimes as farmers, we look at this, and that's, I think, where some of the confusion comes in when we talk about these products. We don't have to use insecticides anymore, and that was a big deal. We don't have to use stuff with half-lives that are really bad for us. But it doesn't mean these are acceptable best practices. You know, the whole thing about sustainability is continuous improvement, and any time you'd settle for a best practice means you're not on a journey into sustainability. So as we move forward, we found out that cover crops enhanced our no-till system. We found out that grazing enhanced it even more by building organic matter in the soil and some of these very positive things. And anyway, it's been good. Here are the results. On the cow herd, to give some true cost revenue breakdowns, this would be old pinhook farm, here's new pinhook farm. By eliminating the chemicals and fertilizer, that saved me $59.50 an acre on average for nitrogen, or for chemical treatment about once every 3 years. By eliminating nitrogen, we save about $84.40 $44.80 a cow. Our feed use has been reduced. The cover crops reduced at about 50 cents a day for 45 days. Grazing the cover crops has helped compared to our old method. Basically, a lot of things go into making your production better. The most important thing to measure is pounds of calf weaned per cow exposed. So as we had more rotational grazing with more diversity, we actually saw our pregnancy rates go up, our calving rates improved. We wound up weaning more pounds of calf per cow than we used to. The difference is right here. With the new system, we weaned 539.4 pounds of calf per cow. With the old system, we were weaning 476 pounds per cow. When you take this combined with the savings, the difference is $376.86 per calf, more than I was making in the old way. It's helped my crops as well. Now, first of all, I am not a crop farmer. I'm a cow guy that raises crops to feed his cows, so I'm not going to have as much data there. But it has been good. Going to no-till tillage cost me $40 an acre. Getting in an integrated system with the crop rotation has reduced our nitrogen amounts significantly. We're looking at $49.60 an acre for about 80 pounds of nitrogen the way we're farming now versus about $93 for 150 pounds of nitrogen. Total savings are around $83 an acre. The other thing that's happening, and I'm not quite sure how to measure, as we improve the structure and porosity of our soil with the cover crops, we're able to get in and plant our crops in a timely manner. This year was a great example. We had a lot of my neighbors weren't able to because they could not get out on the fields. And we're also seeing better resiliency during drought, during times of drought. So just like Kristine pointed out, the soil holds the water better and we're making it through. But I think what's pretty cool next, some other really wonderful things happened. When we stopped spraying pasture and we saw the need for legumes, we got more clover, more flowers, more pollinators, and once again, the clover not only has brought more pollinators to us, it's added in the nitrogen in the soil. We've seen more birds, which excites me, and I think birds are wonderful indicators that I'm doing something right. We've seen more wildlife, and this has led to me discovering that we really don't have a shortage of corn and soy, but we do have a shortage of clean water, healthy soil, and wild things. And this has led to more revenue, because the laws of supply and demand still work. As our wildlife came back, this little guy, the Indiana bat, showed up on our farm. The Indiana bat is an endangered species, which to some few farmers will strike fear in their hearts. But in our case, we took a little different approach. Instead of complaining about not being able to cut down trees and destroy his habitat, we hired a survey firm and GPS mapped the entire location of all the bat's habitat. We worked to develop a grazing plan so that we made sure our cows could work with the bat. And we now offer, and through the involvement of a company called the Green Fuels Exchange in Des Moines, we now offer land mitigation credits to companies who want to offset their building footprint, trying to seek sustainable site credits for LEED certification. So I guess that would be my argument that it's, besides being the right thing to do, you can make money at protecting things. And our outfitting business grew, and we've really found out, I was not a hunter, but I found out that good hunters are really critical to helping protect the environment. They're some of the best conservationists I've ever worked at or worked with. All right, key economic and social barriers facing farmers and moving to specialized and integrated systems. I'm going to start right here. I think this is the one that confuses me the most. 50% of the U.S. population is concentrated in these 146 counties. No one lives in the heartland. And I come and I hear about people wanting locally grown, sustainable food, and I say it's really hard to get it to you guys. If I'm going to make a pitch, I guess the best way I'd put it is healthy communities need healthy farms need healthy communities. And if there's something that can come out of this conference, how can we bring people back specifically to Iowa? And I'll give an example. You know, North Carolina, PayPal just told North Carolina, we don't want to go to your state because of your position on same-sex marriage. Iowa's had same-sex marriage for 7 years. We're a live and let live state. We've got a lot going for us, and we've got great internet and telecommunication services. Try something new, bring your business to Iowa, we'll set you up. Anyway, federal crop insurance is frustrating. The renewable fuel standard, the 1031 tax-free exchange, these are all policies, well-intended policies, that have some very negative unintended consequences. And I think about what my mother always told me, you know, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. I don't know that we need to throw them clear out, but they've caused problems. I think we need to enforce compliance. Cheap oil is a problem. As long as we have it, people are going to have the desire to simply convert fossil fuel calories into corn and other things. Desire and apathy are a big one. I think one thing that would be very beneficial, this is a 24/7 365-day-a-year business. You have to care about livestock. You have to have the desire to do it. I believe that we should take a little bit different approach and a little bit better attitude on our immigration policies and maybe see if that is an avenue that more people can come in and have an opportunity to do this. Poverty is a challenge. If you don't have enough to eat, if you're hungry, if you can't pay your rent, you're not going to be out advocating for clean water and things of that nature. You're trying to feed your family. That's a challenge, but I think that, once again, it's also an unintended consequence of a broken system. And linear thinking. Instead of asking how, let's start asking why things are the way they are. And the future, you know, on Pinnock Farm, we're going to keep doing the things we do. That's my daughter and I and her 4-H calf. If she wants to farm, that's great. If she doesn't, that's fine, too. We're pretty obsessed with trying to reduce our reliance on fossil fuel. We're doing little things. We have an electric four-wheeler now. We're thinking about maybe a solar panel to charge it with, you know, stuff like that. We'll continue to work on our grazing systems, continue to look at more opportunities. But in reality, unless we have a drastic change in our farming systems, the things I've worked on my farm won't work. They can't survive. So I've made a short wish list of what I want. And I'm going to start here. I really want us to see us change the way we farm to follow the principles of conservation agriculture. I see Dr. Montgomery in the back, and I thought about this going in. You know, I think there's a lot of attitude that believes, and it's probably true, farms may get bigger for the foreseeable future. But if we change our farming practices and invest in our natural resources, then maybe people will move back to the Midwest, and then we can have the locally grown farms and some of the opportunities you want. And then buzzing right through, we need to focus on creating responsible landowners. Once again, I think that will feed into the need. I think that will take care of the problem of finding more farmers. We need to enforce compliance on federal crop insurance. We need to make our decisions, and I'm going to take it a step further. We need to make these decisions on calories and dollars. If you're dealing with a skewed economic system, dollars are not always the best way to use. And as my friends have pointed out, you know, calories aren't the best either. We have to make them based on nutritional value per acre would be my ask. And agriculture is an art and a science, and we need to return to teaching this way. If we want to solve our problems, once again, we've got to use the left side and the right side of our brain. You know, we have to feel things. If something looks bad, feels bad, smells bad, tastes bad, sounds bad, it might be bad.
That's it.
Thank you. Don't go away, sir.
Okay.
Take a seat there. Thank you very much.
Indeed. Thank you, Seth. If all those panelists would like to come back and take their seats now, I'm going to start with you, Seth. I'll let you run on a little bit longer than you should have done because it was such a fascinating presentation and really important to what we've been discussing. Just a short answer to this, one very simple question. You talked about that very severe winter. Mm-hmm. Have you experienced any greater extremes of climate during your farming life? Would you say that there's any evidence that climate change is making your farming system more difficult, or is it not really, is it just seasonal?
No, climate change,
climate
change is very real, and we play a big part in it. I'm just trying to find a way to work through it right now, and we had 108 inches of rainfall this year. That's three times our normal rainfall. We're dealing with huge extremes. Conservation agriculture helps solve those problems, but we've got to get the carbon out of the atmosphere and back in the soil.
And then you're finding you're having to, you get a smaller window for making hay or for planting crops. I'm certainly finding this in the UK that we're having quite a lot of problems because in the past where you could be a bit relaxed about things, today you've got to get up in the middle of the night to get the crops in the ground sometimes, otherwise you're too late.
This is one of the challenges with cereal grains for us, for one. With getting crops in, we're seeing our planters get bigger and bigger, which does make some challenges in our area. And the other is, I think you saw up there, when we were harvesting our corn, we've moved to chopping more feed because we simply cannot get our first cutting of alfalfa up in a timely manner. So we've had to change our equipment to adapt, but that's just a Band-Aid.
Okay, now I'm going to put a question to each of the panelists and then we'll open it up to the floor. I'm going to put a general question which I think possibly George and Seth might just make a comment on, which is that, and you can all correct me if you think I'm wrong on this, one of the major reasons why it's actually very difficult to find good examples of integrated farming systems. I mean, when we look for photographs for our website and things like that, really hard to come by where you can actually in one photograph capture that diversity these days, is because going down the route of specialization and monocultures and factory farming is actually more profitable because you have to invest less capital. You can specialize, you can learn the skills of a particular area, and while agrochemicals are doing the job of controlling weeds, pests, and diseases, it's all working fine. now we've got some big problems coming up with antibiotic resistance in livestock production, with some diseases becoming resistant to chemicals, but how long it'll be before those become critical problems is anybody's guess. Now, Seth, you and you, George, you're both actually running ahead in a way of what we're saying at this conference. You're actually finding farmers who are willing to go on a journey while the crop insurance programs are still really pushing them in the wrong direction. How do you explain that, and how difficult are you finding it to get farmers to sign up to what you're doing? I think you said you've got 100 farmers. What are the incentives for them? I think it's probably on at the moment, is it?
I think it's on. Well, two things. I think some of these, the farmers that are trying to increase and improve their profitability with cattle, they lost some of their fields during the run-up in corn prices, because the competition was such that landowners chose to move them to row crops and rent them out to folks doing row crops. So they are looking for ways to replace that. And one of the ways that they can replace that is to improve the productivity in their own land by increasing the stocking density. So the modeling suggests, and I think the reality suggests, you can go from in that neighborhood 1.2, say, animal units per acre to 1.8 animal units per acre if it's managed well, just as an example. And then the other thing is that if we can convince the Nature Conservancy, the Minnesota DNR, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, and some of them are moving, that their natural areas are degrading without grazing, because they can't always be burned when they need to be burned. They need grazing. They need animal impact. Grassland is not a resting situation, it's a disturbance situation. Then with good access, we can help the farmers and help the agencies manage their land. So that's part of their interest. Many of these people don't use that much crop insurance. So yes, they get some benefit from it, but on the livestock side, they don't get much benefit from the crop insurance program itself.
Absolutely not. Just a brief comment, Seth. Let me ask you this. Would you say that you're slightly atypical in the sense that your farm, judging by the photographs, has got some land which isn't actually suitable for continuous corn soil production? So you already had a livestock enterprise anyway. So what you weren't like someone who'd got 3,000 acres of flat land that's just ideal for corn soya. Would you say those sort of farmers are going to face different challenges from the ones that you've faced if they wanted to make their systems more integrated?
No, I think they'd integrate in a different way. You know, I'll give an example. There's a great farmer in Washington County named Steve Berger. And Steve is a hog producer, and he was one of the pioneers in Iowa on using cover crops and identifying the aspect of what we call a leaky system, you know. So in Steve's case, because of the kind of land he has, this is where it gets kind of hard for me to not confine animal feeding operations. Here's a guy that, as much as I don't like him and I don't like what's going on with the pigs inside of him, what he's doing from his land because of it is absolutely incredible. And he's been a real leader for a lot of the things we're trying to do. Now, you know, as you move forward in a perfect world, as those buildings wear out, and this is one of the problems, anything in livestock, you don't want to buy things that depreciate. And that's what all those buildings do. As they depreciate and wear out, maybe we'll come into a world where we start to raise the hogs in a different way.
Thank you. Kristine, you talked about soil carbon. Tell us a bit about what specifically is going to build soil carbon. What do we actually need to do to take carbon back out of the atmosphere and put it back in the soil? We talked a bit at lunch about the difference between using cover crops and using grass integrated systems. Give us an overview of how you see those different approaches.
Well, I think the biggest key is the whole idea of first off, having something green and growing as much as possible. And so as we're looking at it, being able to keep a plant growing. Now, in a row crop production system, and if you're just a non-integrated farmer, just into row crop production, you can utilize cover crops as a tool to keep the land green and growing and to keep a growing plant there, and you're going to be putting carbon below ground. But part of what happens with driving carbon below ground is it's going to happen more often while the plant is growing through its vegetative growth state. And so when you have these very integrated systems where you're doing some grazing, you're going to be keeping the plant in that vegetative growth state. That's going to be keeping that carbon cycling below ground as opposed to carbon going into reproduction phases. You're also going to be putting more carbon below ground when you're doing the grazing. And as you have grazing that happens, the plant roots, not only are you utilizing plants oftentimes that have some deeper rooting structure and more fibrous rooting structure, but you're also going to have some of those roots, when they're being grazed, they're actually being pulled and tugged on, and some of the root hairs are going to break off. And that's going to release some exudates into the soil environment, which is going to stimulate more microbial activity and more carbon going below ground. We've seen, you know, in the way that we're managing systems, that we can get carbon going deeper into the soil with these types of management. Now, people would say, well, you know, I could not have an animal grazing and I could go with having a perennial crop and I may hay that perennial crop off. Again, you don't get that same level of tugging. So you don't get the breaking of the root hairs. You don't get as much carbon below going below ground. You also get a different wounding pattern on the plant. And the way the plant can respond to wounds, when you do sort of a slicing action, it's a very small wound that the plant can cover up. In order to be able to respond to the wounds, they need to have resources. They need to have mineral resources to make the proteins that are utilized to cover those wounds, to seal them up. When you're doing grazing, it tears so much more of the leaf tissue that there's more of those proteins that need to be produced to seal up those wounds. So they're going to exude more resources below ground to stimulate more biological activity and get that. So everything works together. It's not that you can't get to a plateau or get to achieving better soil carbon sequestration with a row crop system and utilizing cover crops, but you're not going to be able to get to the same plateau that you would be able to get with grazing. And so even if you're not going to eat an animal, having an animal there, if we went away from an animal consumption, we need to have grazing.
Great. Thank you very much. And now I'm going to ask Claire, tell us a bit more about your farmers. What's the incentive for them in getting involved? Have you just recruited people for the experiment? Are they getting any financial reward for that? And what would you see as the prospects of getting other commercial producers to adopt some of the techniques that you've been introducing in your research to make the systems more integrated?
Yeah, we're really looking at farmers that are already doing what they want to be doing. So, you know, we're studying what's out there. So, you know, the farmers that are doing the really diversified production systems are generally going for a different market than the farmers that are primarily growing, you know, just strawberry or maybe strawberry and raspberry. They may often be growing for a large contract buyer like Driscoll's or like Whole Foods. So, you know, they're already doing what they want to be doing. We haven't asked them to do anything different. We really want to study what they are doing and try to better understand. So I didn't really say this, but we're, in addition to the biodiversity and the ecosystem services, we're also wanting to understand how this plays out for their bottom line. So what is the economics of their different production systems, and also how are they perceiving of the management practices that they are using? What benefits do they feel they're getting from those practices, or what costs? And I hope all of our farmers will be kind of like you and be able to just give us that balance sheet. I'm not sure if it'll be that easy, but I think that one of the things that we really want to understand is what's the sort of, what we measure on the farm as far as ecosystem services goes, does that match up with what the farmers feel like they're getting from these management practices? And we think that ultimately all of this information will be very useful in helping to devise outreach plans, you know, to better understand what are the economics of a highly diversified system, what are the benefits, what are the costs, and then can we then translate that into some outreach for growers?
Thank you. Now, I'm going to open this up to the floor. If you'd like to speak, just wait a second before I hand you, until I hand you the microphone. If you'd like to give us your name and where you come from, please do. If you'd like to make a point, please do. Try to keep them as brief as possible, but to the point. So who'd like to ask the first question or make a point? And keep the microphone fairly close to your mouth.
Hi, my name's Eva. I'm from Food First, but I'm actually from Australia, which is where I'm going to generate this question from. And it's building upon this last comment. I would say one of the biggest barriers for farmers in Australia to adopt biodiverse and integrative farming is the retail sector. We have a uniquely high concentration of supermarket power in Australia. We have two supermarkets controlling 85% of the grocery sector. And so that's naturally seen fewer farmers on larger tracts of land growing fewer crops and less diverse farming systems. And the only farmers that are really engaging in biodiverse systems are the ones that have magically found alternate networks. So I'm wondering, with your engagement with farmers and as a farmer, if you've found that this market access is a significant barrier to integrating diverse farming systems.
Okay, thank you. Now, who'd like to answer that? Well, I'm going to give that question to one of you to start off with. Who'd like to answer that most, George?
I can take a start. I think markets are a huge question. So, if you're living in an area where the elevator isn't taking much wheat, then it's going to you don't have a market for it. For example, we're trying to connect farmers to most of these farmers are not doing grass-fed meat. It's going into the conventional system, even though it's pasture raised. So there's more there's that potential growth, but a number of the companies that have done grass-fed meat in Minnesota have been bought by JBS or the largest. So it's hard to maintain the infrastructure that doesn't get bought up by the biggest corporates. So this is a real dilemma. And I expect that happened because they had outside investors that wanted their money out, you know, and forced the sale.
Does anybody want to comment? Do you want to comment on this?
I could just make one comment is that something that we have seen some growers do is to work together with other growers. So they may be doing a very diversified production system, and they do have that challenge of reaching the market because, you know, so many of the outlets are going to be for much larger amounts of any given product than they can produce. But sometimes they have worked together with other growers, and then there'll be like a one grower who will sort of be the concentrator and will bring a lot of these things together, and then they can have different market access than they otherwise would have. So I think that's a really positive thing that can happen, and that maybe we need more infrastructure or more policies and other things that can help promote that as well.
Okay, I expect you can comment on this too, but I'm going to move on to another question. But if we run out of questions, we'll come back and let you comment on this as well in a moment or two. The next question, thank you.
Great. Thank you, Tom Sargent from here. Thank you all. That was really a great panel. I got 50 questions, but there's one that just leaves me confounded, which is the Seth, you said that enforce the compliance of federal crop insurance, and I was just wondering if you could just explain that technically a little bit more, because crop insurance has come up so many times today, and I don't fully understand what the right thing to do there is.
Just hold up the microphone in case you want to respond.
Oh, okay.
I'll do my best because I'm not a policy expert, but what has happened is during the last farm bill, I think you know it was delayed primarily because there was a fight over whether or not we should make me as a farmer meet certain standards to get the money that U.S. taxpayers give me to subsidize our federal crop insurance. The specific area I'm going to talk about, it's really only what's called highly erodible land and wetlands are the two real big areas they're talking about. And what it comes down to is, it's simply saying on the farming practices, if you have highly erodible land and you're going to farm it, you need to contour a farm, you need to leave the headlands and grass, and you need to use no-till and other practices necessary to prevent ephemeral gullies and a certain level of sheet and roll erosion. A couple of things happened. One, for me as a grass farmer, and this is a biased, when I was competing for grazing acres, people could buy the pasture land I was buying for grazing acres at a higher price, so I did lose market share because of that. But the sand thing, and that's fine. If they want to go buy that and farm it and do a good job, you know, that's free markets and that's real life. But I'm seeing way too many cases where the farming practices are not, they're using the practices that put them out of the compliance. They're having ephemeral gullies. They're having sheet and rill erosion. They're not contour farming. They're farming the headlands. And this is bad for all of us. You know, if you want to go wreck a business or something, you can build it back and make it as good as new again in a year. But if you want to take that land, we're talking about things that are going to take thousands of years to fix. And it's very frustrating to me because we don't enforce those rules. And it also is kind of sad because we have the Natural Resource Conservation Service. And they're kind of the good guys. They're who I should go to learn how to make problems better on my farm. But we've also made them be the enforcer at the same time. And it's a social dynamic. I hope I'm not making too much of a stretch, but I compare it a lot to the Jim Crow laws that we face during civil rights.
Thank you.
You happy with that? Or do you want to ask? Yeah. Anybody got a burning point they want to add to on that?
I think it also is really important to recognize, in talking with Seth and knowing Seth for a while, he doesn't go in the crop insurance program. And so part of it is, and there's a lot of dynamics with the crop insurance program that make it the compliance that he's talking about for erosion control, but there's also issues with cover crop usage and other things like that. If we're going to be in a very good, I think, capitalistic types of society of things, and again, paying for the true cost of food, farmers like Seth are going to make money outside of having to have farm subsidy programs and crop insurance programs. When we start paying for what it costs for food, that is the thing that's going to drive the market. So no matter what it is that, I mean, we can sit here and debate and have an ineffectual Congress and you know, on a global basis or whatever from a policy standpoint. But again, when we start paying the true costs, then we're going to be having farmers that are going to be able to make money. And those are the farmers that are going to stay in business, the ones that are doing the things that allow them to continue to stay in business.
Great.
Crop insurance. We
do need crop insurance, or is it just the bureaucracy of how it works is just in politics of it.
But that crop insurance could be used in a more constructive way.
Okay.
But I'm encouraged, Kristine, that you say when, not if, which is great in terms of true cost accounting. And next question. Okay, give us your name as well if you can.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Laura Bryan. I work for Natural Resources Defense Council, and I actually work on crop insurance and what we can do to improve that. So any of you feel free to contact me at any time on things you think we should be working on. And then I was wondering if each of you could speak to the point of landowner and renter agency. What is one thing that you think we should do to make improvements in that area to enable or drive more diversified farming systems?
Who's going to answer that one, George?
One thing I think we have to do is shift the narrative about what's the value of land. So if the value of land is only the highest amount that it can be rented for, and that's what the value of land is, I don't mean this is the only thing we should do, but this is really important because people can make different choices if they go back and say, you know, this land was in the history of our family, if that's the case, or whatever it is that's meaningful to them. I think we have to help people find that. So one of the ways we've done that is we have a play called Look Who's Knocking at the Door, about a beginning farmer coming to a retiring farm couple trying to make a decision about what to do with the land. There's no easy answer to it because there aren't easy answers. This is estate planning. It's all these things. But I do think we have to give people the sense that the opportunity to say this is more means more to me than only the value that I can rent it for or sell it for.
Do you want to go?
I guess I would say too, and George brought this up, there are a lot of land now is being owned by elderly women. and in the U.S. And that is it's an issue of education, I think, for them. And I want to compliment you on the education programs that you sort of showed us pictures of, because I think that that's part of it. And everything that happens within that of, if you want to be doing some things from a more sustainable side of things, write in your agreement with who you're renting the land to. When you feel that land has a certain intrinsic value to you, but you don't have a kid or a grandkid that's going to take it over and you're going to rent it out, that land still has value to you. Make sure that gets conveyed, as George was saying, and you write that into the agreement.
Thank you. Next question.
Sorry, Chris Draper, with your original slide, it was random in some ways. On your original slide, you showed that basically Ireland and Scotland actually were not really depleted grounds, whereas England obviously was significantly to badly depleted. Is there something structurally different about Scotland and Ireland policy-wise that's causing their ground to be better, their soil to be better?
So who were you putting that question to specifically?
You. It was your slide early on your third slide.
Quite deaf and I didn't quite. So just repeat the key point of the question again, because I haven't quite caught everything. Sorry.
Oh, sorry. On your third slide that was on the screen, it showed that it looked like the soil quality of Ireland and Scotland were significantly better than England. Is there a reason for that?
That the soil quality was better in
Ireland and Scotland? Ireland.
Oh, I see.
Ireland.
Would you mean the one, the degradation one?
Yes. Yep.
I don't know. I think that's just come from the United Nations Environment Programme, that slide. I didn't prepare it. You're talking about the one with the global map.
Yeah, I was just curious if there were policies or something in those, because they're not, because they're in the Union, but they're not really.
I don't think so. I think it's just actually just that. I mean, you can't really tell from a map of that sort of scale that how it's been farmed in the past. It's really just a diagrammatic illustration of what proportion of land has actually been degraded by. I think essentially the land that stayed in grass, some of the land which is unsuitable for cropping, will be less degraded than the land that's actually been ploughed and cropped. For example, if you look at the east side of England, East Anglia, around the fens where we had a lot of peat in the soil. That we're still losing 1 million tons of carbon every year from the fenlands in the UK, and we've lost about 12 feet of soil over the last 200 years. So they had hundreds of years of that fertility being, or maybe thousands of years, that fertility being created, and we've used up most of that in the last couple of hundred years. I can't answer more precisely than that, I'm afraid.
Fair enough, thank you.
Matt first, and then you afterwards.
Thank you. Hi, just a question for Seth. So you had a fairly conversion on the road to Damascus, and it's a brave move. Are you finding that your systems and your soils are getting more and more and more fertile, or are you finding that they sort of capped out and have started to plateau? Is this a sort of never-ending road to paradise, or is there just a new normal that you arrive at? That's the first half of the question, and the other half was just the reaction of your neighbours, your farming neighbours, to your journey.
Well, yeah, Mother Nature kind of kicked me in the rear end and put me on a road to, I like that, a road to paradise. That's a really important comment to make, because we don't really learn about these things at our seed corn meetings or our cattlemen's meetings or anything, the terms of sustainability. And the other thing that's really important to me, sustainability in and of itself is kind of pointless. If that's all we're going to do, we're going to lose anyway. So we really have to move toward regeneration. And then I say, well, how do I really measure it? And right now, the best tool I've got is organic matter content in the soil. Now, in our region, it's not uncommon to see soil levels, 1 to 2% organic matter in the southern Iowa Drift Plain. We're now, after, since 98, and really getting aggressive with the cover crops over the last 10 or 12 years, my best field's up to a 5.7. So that's a significant growth because of the combination of livestock, cover crops. I really didn't know what I was doing, why I was doing some of these things. I just got cover crops because I wanted to graze my cows longer. I didn't understand that part. Now, if you looked at the slide, we've taken it to this next level of multi-species, and we even tried to raise some sunflowers in it to see if we could get another crop going. So, and then as far as your question about my neighbors, they're always nice to me. And I think one of the things, actually it goes back to the earlier question about farming agreements. I know there's a little bit of jealousy in my neighborhood, for lack of better words, because I was very careful in who I chose for a landlord, and we were very careful in how we structured our arrangement. I run on a percentage-based arrangement on two farms, and I've been able to have long-term relationships with those landlords because of it. I have the utmost appreciation and respect for my landlords because in 2008, when crop prices went up, they had weekly calls from farm managers and neighbors and other people wanting to take our pastures and convert them into cropland. But we sat down and said, you know, this isn't a two-year return on investment business. This is a long-term sustainable strategy to have a sustainable profit. And more so, something I sat down with our business model, we really believe we have a land company and we have a cattle company and we don't mix them together. And that's helped us a lot. So we look at the land as its own entity, like you look at a bar of gold. And I want to protect it that way. And we look at the cattle separately.
We're running out of time. I want to ask, well, I'll take your question last for a second. I just want to ask Claire a question quickly. Claire, have you got any academic colleagues or others that you're aware of in the sort of research community who are looking at aspects of integrated farming systems on larger scales in different crops from you, or are you really one of the only people in the U.S. doing this sort of work at the moment?
Well, when you talk about integrated cropping systems, you're specifically meaning the integration of livestock as
no,
well.
I'm talking about more diverse systems. It
yeah.
could be just integrated pest management. Just give us an overview.
Yeah, no, I think that
how much more research is needed in those areas.
I think we need a great deal more research, but there certainly are a number of people doing this in the United States as well as abroad. And when I think about integrating the livestock in, I think more of examples from other countries as far as the research side, a little bit more on that. But I really think we need a lot more research because I think that it would be really helpful for to be, especially, you know, research that where researchers really are trying to respond to the needs of farmers to develop specific cropping systems for specific regions. There's always so much, so many details. You know, as we really heard, I think from Christina's work, it's even, you know, the tugging of from the grazing, the tugging of the cows. I never heard that before. That's amazing. But you know, there's so many details to work out, and so I think that we could have a much more adoption if we could provide a lot more information. It's vastly underfunded.
Thank you. Can you pass the microphone? This will probably be the last question, and I may have to ask for fairly snappy answers. We'll see how quickly the noise builds up as people go for their coffee, but go ahead.
Great, thank you. My name is Greg Richardson. I've really enjoyed the panel, so thank you. My question is related to livestock integration into cropland, and as a cattleman, I imagine it's... I assume that it's maybe a little bit easier to integrate livestock into your cropping systems than if you were a... someone who only did crops and was thinking about integrating livestock. And so I was wondering, what do you see? Do you see that as a barrier that there may be corn, soy, other, you know, grain type growers that may see integrating livestock into their operation as a headache and they don't want to go there? Could there be contracts with livestock operators? Have you seen that happen? And do you see food safety issues as being a major hurdle in making this happen at a broader scale?
Who wants to answer that question first? George?
I think contract grazing is a real opportunity. We're experimenting with that in our area, but there have to be folks with cattle that in the vicinity that, you know, it's reasonable to haul cattle to a different pasture. So one of the things that we need in the country is how do we reseed livestock operations throughout the Corn Belt, where largely there are no more animals on the land. They're all out of the land and in confined animal feeding operations. So how do we reseed, if you will, livestock operations that could contract graze, even cover crops and row crops, is a really interesting question.
And there's a big issue there, which is that we all need to take a more detailed look at the greenhouse gas emissions associated with grazing livestock, because it's actually true that corn-fed cattle in feedlots use less methane per pound of meat that they put on than grazing livestock animals. But that doesn't take into account all the other... That doesn't take into account all the other factors that actually alter that equation. So we need to go back and revisit some of that and realize that many of the statistics we've been given are quite misleading. Kristine.
I was going to say that one of the approaches that we've taken is that on our research farm, every crop field is also a pasture. And we rotate through both perennial pasture as well as grain crop production. But we're also involved in a research project with Iowa State and the University of Minnesota, where we're looking at this whole idea of an integrated crop livestock system and looking at all of the economics, as well as you brought up food safety. So again, you know, funding some research to take a look at that. So we've got, we've collected fecal samples, we're collecting some meat samples, looking at some of these food safety issues and really getting good data. That's a good, interesting thing for research to be doing, is looking at the effects of grazing on some of the food safety issues.
Claire, have you got any further comments on anything you want to say before we're going to wind it up fairly soon? Is there anything else, any other point you'd like to make, even without a question?
No, I think not.
You're happy? Okay. Seth, have you got anything else you want to add?
Just one quick thing. Yeah. Your question about grazing, actually, there's some genuine opportunities. What we're seeing, there are a lot of cattle fed in Iowa. One of the things we're working toward is using less and less or eliminating antibiotic use. So what we've looked at in the state is with our larger feedlots, we're just copying what they've done in Kansas for decades. We're looking at grazing the cover crops in with the feedlot. So you have your supply of cattle, your supply of calves. And the other issue that is starting to get serious consideration is getting out of the paradigm that cover crops are just for winter. And we're looking at some perennial type use in the summer to build back soil.
Very quick point then. Thank you.
It's a one sentence answer. Do you think that the land that you have increased from 1% to 5.7% is now more valuable on the market in terms of organic matter? Would people pay a higher price for that?
They will when they get hungry.
And do you think a tenant would pay more to get that land because they think they could get a higher yield?
That's where I think you have to move to a share crop or a percentage based lease instead of a cash rent. So both partners, share the risk and the reward.
Right, thank you all very, very much indeed, and thank you for coming. We've been probably the smallest group in this breakout session. I think the future of food scored highest in the popularity stakes was producing food from algae and things of that. Well, there's a lesson in that for us all about what interests people. But while we've been a small group, I feel we've actually covered some very important topics. Hopefully, providing the technology has worked, it's all been recorded and it will be put on our website. Any of you who didn't come yesterday, I'd urge you to look at the website in a week or so's time when everything's on there, because the sessions yesterday, the plenary sessions, were some of them were really sparkling at the beginning, and I think you'll be inspired by them if you haven't heard them. If you didn't see the Tale of Two Chickens animation, because it wasn't very clear, that will be on our website as well. And I'd just like to thank you all for taking part for a very, very exciting discussion, and ask you to show your appreciation to our panelists here.